I will tell you that coming into this service, some apprehension, and as someone who does this all the time, I think that was a healthy dose of the Lord's humility for me. But something happened last night. It happened during the worship service. Any of you ever have an experience with the Holy Spirit when singing In Christ Alone? Anybody ever have that happen to you? It's funny how it hits you differently each time, like a passage of Scripture that you've been over many, many times, and yet it hits you and you are surprised by it. And I'll tell you what hit me last night as I was even thinking about this morning. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled and strivings cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. And then, of course, this is the one that put me over the edge. As he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. And then it occurred to me, I read that somewhere. Revelation tells us we were bought with the blood of Christ. We're going to actually be looking at Revelation this morning, and I thought, oh my gosh, he's already got the victory. It's already done. I'm good. I just got to step into what God has already done. Amen? And I still want you to pray for me, though, because I want to make sure that the Word of God goes forth and accomplishes the purposes for which it is established. And so if you would, I invite you to stand for the Word of God that we might show respect. And I'm going to ask if you would place your hands, if you don't have your Bibles with you, just place your hands in that posture of relinquishment and reception that you might receive what the Lord has for you this day from Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. We have heard this multiple times at this assembly, but I pray the Holy Spirit would help you to hear it fresh and anew. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count. From every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb, where they were wearing white robes and holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all of the angels, well, they were standing around the throne, around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down on their faces before the throne, and they worshiped God, saying, "Oh, amen. Praise and glory, wisdom and thanks and honor, power and strength to our God forever and ever." And everyone said, "Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "Those in the white robes, where have they come from? Who are they?" I answered, "Sir, you know." He said, "Yes, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat upon them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will lead them to the springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." My friends, the grass will wither and the flower will fall, but this is God's word that endures forever. Amen? Amen? Amen. Please be seated. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of each of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you. You are our rock. You are our Redeemer. I pray, Lord, that you would come and work your Spirit among us and lead us in all truth. May you be high exalted and lifted up and glorified. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Here I am at the end of my time serving as the moderator, and I'm still learning things. I'm still learning quite a few things. One of the things I've learned this week is that you might want to not take the last sermon of the General Assembly. You see, Rufus, in response to you, years ago, I, at my invitation, Rufus was invited by the CCO to speak at their Jubilee conference. And it was pretty much on my word that they brought him in. And they brought him in because I knew him to be the man that he is and can preach the way he does. And I was pretty excited about his being there. And right before he went up to preach, he leaned into me and he said, "Dean," he said, "I had a truly great sermon prepared for today. I mean, I thought the Lord gave me a great sermon, but I think I'm going to preach something different." And everything inside of me said, "No, no, no, go with the great sermon, please." So in the spirit and attitude of that, right, as I've listened to the preaching this week, I came and I listened to my brother Eli Morris preach, and he talked about how, you know, we need to have this attitude and put others first like Christ did. And I thought, well, all right, I got to go back and rework part of my sermon because I was going to say something like that. All right, week kind of went along, and then Rufus gets up to preach, and I mean, first of all, you don't ever want to preach after Rufus. That's one thing, right? Amen, preachers? And then he started talking about this idea of the harvest, and I was going to say something about the harvest, and so I thought I'd better go back and rework that part of my sermon, too. I thought, but still, you know, probably, you know, 80% of what I had prepared, I'm still going to be good for. And I had a whole lot I was going to say about Genesis chapter 12 and verse 3. And Abraham's blessing unto the nations. I went home last night and I thought to myself, okay, Lord, I'm going to have to rework this. But at least they didn't take my seminal text. They didn't take Revelation 7, 9. And then Bruce Anderson gets up last night at the end of the service and gives the benediction and quotes Revelation 7, 9. I said, okay, Lord, now what do you want me to do? And he caused me to listen in carefully to something that our brother Ligon said. Ligon said that one of the ways in which God had blessed Abram was that he gave him a name. And as that was resonating inside of my being, I almost feel like I heard the Lord say to me, "Dean, I gave you a name too. My name is Weaver. So why don't you just weave it all together, son?" So we're going to, here at the end of all things, see if we can't put all those pieces together that we've heard throughout the course of the week. We started with that whole idea from Ephesians chapter 3, or Philippians chapter 3, that we're supposed to forget what lies behind and press forward toward that upward call that we have in Jesus Christ. And all week long, there's this sense of the Holy Spirit's momentum among us in big gatherings and small gatherings and hallway conversations, in singing and preaching and speaking and praying, that God is moving us forward. We're not where we were, but we're not yet where we will be. God is not done with the EPC. God has something ahead for us. So we press on and we move forward. It's always helpful for me in moving forward to be able to keep my end destination in view, if you will. So, for example, if you are going to leave Memphis today and you were going to head out to California and I asked you where you were heading to, you say, "Oh, it's some city that begins with an S." I would say, well, you might want to be a little more precise because you could end up in San Diego. You could end up in Sacramento. And if you're not careful, you could end up in Seattle. Keeping that end in view, the Greek word teleos, keeping the end in front of us, helps us orient to where we're going. It lays out the pathway for us so that we know where we are going, where we are headed, what God's purposeful destination for is. His future for us is laid out faithfully in His Word. And that's what brings us to Revelation 7 and 9, here at almost the end of all things. But before we do that, I need to take a couple of steps back before we can ramp up, if you will. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and open with me to Revelation chapter 1, because we got to set the stage here a little bit, like a good Memphis barbecue. We got to lay out that table with some stuff that's going to get our juices flowing. Revelation 1 and 1, John writes, "These are the things that must soon take place." That ought to get our attention. That ought to create in us a sense of urgency. The things that must soon take place. I always find it interesting how selective we are in the things of God's Word that we think are actually true. Do we really truly believe that these are things that must soon take place? Do we live in that kind of eschatological tension? I hope so, because this isn't me saying it. It goes on then in verse 2 and says, "This is the word of God, the testimony of Jesus." This isn't Dean talking now. This is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus that these things will soon take place. And then he tells us something important to hear, church. He tells us in verse 3, "Blessed are those who hear it, and blessed are those who take it to heart." Sometimes as Presbyterians, if we're honest with ourselves, we're about 18 inches away from salvation. We love to accumulate the knowledge and the information, and that's all good. But at some point, the transformation of our minds must change our hearts and behaviors. In verse 5, we learn that Jesus is the ruler of all the kings of the earth. That's important because in verse 6, he tells us he's made us to be a kingdom and priests. You and I are made to be his kingdom and his priests. And the one who tells us that, according to verse 8, is the Alpha and the Omega, the one who is and was and is to come. That Alpha and Omega is described in some very vivid details as chapter 1 continues. My favorite is down in verse 15. It's the sound of rushing waters. Can you hear his voice? This week, have you heard his voice? Verse 18 tells us he's the living one, the one that holds the key to death and Hades. Have you heard his voice? Well, of course, chapters 2 and 3 get into those seven churches, those seven churches in Asia Minor. And those seven churches, there's two of them that come out pretty decent, and there's two of them out that come out pretty bad. The two that come out pretty decent, the one is Smyrna, and the other is Philadelphia. I wonder if it's lost on you at this assembly about the scripture and the words of the church at Smyrna. Look with me in chapter 2, in verse 8 and following. Remember, Smyrna is where Andrew Brunson is in prison. Keep that in mind as you hear these words. Now listen to this. In verse 10, "Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer, for I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you." I mean, come on now. This isn't like 2,000 years ago. This is right now. Our brother is living this out in Smyrna right now, this prophecy. And his daughter was up on this stage speaking to us. And we sang his hymn, "Worthy of My All." Did you catch in "Worthy of My All" the lyric that's in there that says he hopes to obtain the crown of life? That's right there in verse 10. That is not lost on our brother Andrew, nor should it be lost on us. Well, the other church that comes out semi-good on this is the church at Philadelphia. In verse 8, it says, I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and not denied my name. I don't know if you know about this, but this might be a prophecy of the Philadelphia Eagles. You see, the two quarterbacks for the Philadelphia Eagles, those two gentlemen are strong believers in Jesus Christ, and I believe they have kept his word and kept his name, and the Philadelphia Eagle fans would say, yes, down in verse 10, we have endured patiently. Now, having grown up in Philadelphia, I feel it okay for me to say, this is clearly Philadelphia eisegesis, not exegesis. You have read into the text something that clearly is not there. But the church of brotherly love, Philadelphia, well, they kept God's word, and they endured patiently. The two that don't come off so hot are the church of Sardis. They think they're alive, but in fact that they're dead. Only a remnant remains. But the worst of the worst has got to be Laodicea, right? Boy, you don't want to be that church. They think that they're rich, but it turns out that they're wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked, lukewarm. And God says he wants to spit them out of his mouth. What kind of church will the EPC be? Do you hear his voice? Chapter 4 takes us above the tapestry, if you will. It takes us to the very throne of heaven. And typically, Revelation does that. It goes above the tapestry, below the tapestry, above the tapestry, below the tapestry, above in heaven, and usually that's worship taking place, below on the earth, and that's usually judgment taking place. So when we go above the tapestry in chapter 4, we see worship breaking out in the very thrones of heaven. We see those living creatures and those 24 elders laying down their crowns. The holy, 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 and the worthy is God. The singing begins. In chapter 5, there's a transition from heaven to earth as the worship spills out of heaven and comes down to the earth. And there finally is a new song that comes to the earth, that comes out of heaven itself. You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals because you were slain. Listen to this now. With your blood, you purchased men for God from every tribe, from every language, every people, and every nation. And you have made them to be a kingdom and priests that serve our God and reign on the earth. That's an echo forward from chapter 1. You and I are that kingdom. You and I are those priests. He has made us to be that. So this, my friends, is our song. Well, chapter 6 comes back down under the tapestry, and we've got some judgment. And man, do we got some judgment. The infamous four horsemen of the apocalypse, if you will, our first introduction to some of the martyrs. But then, as if all of the first six chapters have come to a close, there is a summary question that is asked at the end of chapter 6 in verse 17, which acts like the subject of the big idea of the first part of this book. The question is asked, after all that you have seen and heard, who can stand? After all that you have heard, this Jesus who has called us to be a kingdom and priests, this Jesus who is the Alpha and the Omega, this Jesus who's come to the church and found us in many respects, in most respects, wanting. This one who now brings judgment upon the earth, with that judgment devastating, the question for the entire earth is who can stand? And the answer to that question Revelation 7:9 says, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne. Standing before the throne. Scholars refer to this as the great end time army of God. The first 8 verses of chapter 7 is referring to those in that great end time army of God who come from God's covenant with his people Israel. But this is where you and I come in. Not the 144,000, but numbers too great to count. I love the distinction that Andrew's daughter brought to us yesterday from Andrew himself, who said there are martyrs and there are living martyrs. It looks like when we're in chapter 5, those who are close and under the throne are those who have given their lives for the gospel. But this is so many numbers, hundreds of thousands of people that you can't possibly even count. It is all who have come through that great tribulation. It is the great end time army of God. It is his kingdom and his priests. It is you and me. Who can stand but the family of God? And that is you and me. And we're the ones who stand, not because we have the strength to stand, but because, as this scripture says, he has bought us with his blood, and he has purchased people from every tribe, nation, people, and language. The great end time army of God and the weapons of our warfare are mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. They are not the conventional weapons that this world knows. Our weapons are the weapons of love and forgiveness and reconciliation. Immaculate taught us that. Our weapons will require us to get messy, even prophetic, stepping in to right historic wrongs, to stand for justice for the marginalized. Greg Thompson reminded us of that. Our weapons will require us to care for the least of these and the most vulnerable among us. Jennifer Ross taught us that. To do that, as Eli reminded us, we're going to have a different attitude, take up the attitude of that which was Christ Jesus and put other people ahead of ourselves. And once we do that, then we can begin to build on this blueprint that Rufus laid out for us, where Jesus went, saw, said, and sent. The thing that will always stick with me, Rufus, from your message was the truth that there are many who love to sit around the master's table, but there are none who are going out into the fields to work. But you know, here's the interesting thing. Last night on this stage, we saw some who said yes to going out into the field to work. And as I looked across that stage, I tell you, were any of you blown away by the first man and woman that walked out on this stage? I was doing the math in my head, and I came up with this fact. He's a lot older than me. One of my friends, Harper Brady, was sitting right in front of me, and Harper turned around on me, and he said, "Shame on me for thinking I was ever going to retire." But you know, as I looked across that stage, you know what I saw? I saw Revelation 7:9 standing right in front of us. Revelation 7:9. What that means is this nation, tribe, people, and language is a church that is transcultural, intergenerational, and multilinguistic. I love my brother Marcelo Robles, and I love the fact, Marcelo, you had us pray this morning the Lord's Prayer in our languages. Because you do understand, right, that when we get to heaven, it's not going to be in English. I mean, I'm not saying English won't be there. I'm just saying people are going to come from every nation, every tribe, every people, and every language. That is the picture of what God has set out in front of us. And my sense is, the sooner we get with the program, the better. If we want to cooperate with what God has laid out in his word, then I think like Abraham, whom blessing came and promised in chapter 12 and verse 3, that we, when we are a church that looks like every tribe, every nation, every people, and every language, then I believe the blessings of Abraham, 4,000 years old, will be poured out upon the EPC. And I think we need to confess the fact that the homogeneous church growth principle of the 1980s, where the birds of the feather that flock together, is not found in the Bible anywhere. I mean, if you have your Bibles, turn with me. Acts chapter, this is my favorite. I love this one. Go with me to Acts chapter 17. Every person should have their reformed pedigree measured against their knowledge of Acts chapter 17, verse 26 and 27. This is where it starts. Acts 17, 26 and 27. From one man, he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that people would seek him and perhaps reach out and find him, though he's not far from any one of us. Well, that takes us back to Genesis 1, 26 and 28. All of humanity made in God's image. Of course, we all know about Genesis 12 and 3, that all nations, it was God's plan, that all nations in Acts 2 at Pentecost were present when the Spirit fell, giving birth to the church. And here we are in Revelation 7:9, at the end of all things, our destination, the purpose and place that God has for us set out before us, it changes the course of our direction. It causes us to set our course based on the testimony of Jesus that is God's word in Revelation. The end of this passage, you'll notice in 7:9 that they're wearing white robes, holding palm branches. Those are the signs of victory. This is what victory looks like. For me, the journey started all these many years ago when I was at a meeting of evangelical leaders in my former denomination, and there was a battle cry that was given. The battle cry was, stay, fight, and win. It seemed to gain quite a bit of momentum in the room. People were all excited about staying and fighting, but I was probably about 34 years old, and what I didn't know was a lot. And I raised my hand at one point in time because I wasn't smart enough to know I probably shouldn't have. And I asked one of the leaders of that group, I said, you know what, I would be honored to stay alongside of you, to fight alongside of you, but could you do one thing for me? Could you explain what win looks like? And it was as if it had never been thought of before. Staying and fighting was kind of all that they knew. Revelation 7 and 9 shows us what God's win looks like. And the sooner we get about that as a church, the more I believe we step in to the blessings of Abraham and Pentecost as the great end time army of God. Just a curious, how many of you grew up in the church? How many of you who grew up in the church always sat in the same place in your church? All right, I knew Ed Whedon did. That didn't surprise me one bit. My family grew up in the church, always sat in the third pew from the back on the right-hand side. My father was often leading and doing different things. And one Sunday morning, I came in and sat down, and we always sat in descending order. It was my father, then my mother, then my brother, then myself. And I took my rightful place in the Weaver family pew at Woodside Presbyterian Church, and I looked down the pew, and my dad wasn't there. That was not terribly unusual because my dad was often doing different things, maybe ushering, maybe was late teaching a class or something of that nature. But the service got started, and the service got going, and my dad still wasn't there. And when it came time for the sermon, I thought that was highly unusual that my father wouldn't be there. But my mother hushed me and kind of made me sit back and behave myself. And I pulled back and I got ready for the sermon. And as Pastor George got up to preach, he was going to preach on the Ten Commandments. And as he was getting ready to read Exodus chapter 20 and verse 1, he paused. And out came this booming voice above the sanctuary, above where the choir sat in the area where the speakers were for the organ. Out came this booming voice saying, "I am the Lord your God." And everybody kind of did one of these kind of things. And I leaned over and I said to my mother, "Mom, God sounds an awful lot like Dad." George had placed my dad in a strategic place to speak God's word, to get our attention, that we might be formed and shaped as his people. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me." My hope is that this week you have heard a voice like a rolling thunder of mighty waters. That you have heard God's voice speak to you through all of the seminars and all of the sermons, through all of the songs. And that what you've heard is that for now the EPC will go forward toward the upward call. And what that upward call looks like is Revelation 7:9. That, my brothers and sisters, is where God wants us to go. The great end time army of God. Let's pray together.